Okay, good morning. Welcome back. I hope you're well, whoever you are. Today is Thursday, July 28, 2022, class 15 in the series Webusaya Da and Anapanasati, or Buddhist Practice. We're about to start the final chapter of part two from the book The Essential Practice. Roger Bischoff translated from the Burmese. Here in this chapter, which is very long, we'll find many of the same points presented before. Some of it's very familiar. Some of what he said to various audiences is the same as, he says some of the same things in certain of these chapters. This particularly is a dialogue, though, between he and Ubakin. Ubakin, Sayagi Ubakin, was a very important figure, student and teacher in Burmese Vipassana in the 20th century. And interestingly, I mean, this is not my approach, and I kind of came and went from different approaches in Vipassana, but this is Burmese Buddhism, and Burmese Buddhism, was particularly brought to the West by Ubakin and particularly his appointed successors. I don't think he was considered a lineage holder in the same way that I don't know if they even have the same lineage system in Burma as some other tradition, other Buddhist lineages do. In many ways, it seems that he was a bridge between the very austere forest monks, both Webu Sayadaw and another teacher named Ledi Sayadaw, Ledi. Ledi was a forest, Ledi Sayadaw, who had a beautiful forehead, had great forehead, and was a great teacher of both Anapanasati and Buddhist commentary or Abhidhamma. And so if you look at a picture of Ledi Sayadaw, it looks like a young man in the picture. Beautiful, huge, solid, rectangular forehead, and great mind. More of a scholar than Webu Sayadaw, who was more of a practitioner. They're sort of scholar-practitioner types. And Ledi Sayadaw was a scholar monk who may well have been an arahant. And Webu Sayadaw was sort of a monk, a practitioner monk who also knew the teaching, obviously. They both taught Ubakin at different times, and Ubakin then taught many others, particularly lay people, particularly moving into the West. That's the root of Mahasi Sayadaw, or I'm sorry, Goenka. Goenka, which is not a very famous Vipassana teacher, also Burmese, was a student of Ubakin. And so you've got Ledi Sayadaw and Webu Sayadaw, probably both Arahant, through Ubakin, who was a student of whatever attainment, I don't know, transmitting to his students or successors who spread the Dhamma according to the Burmese Vipassana tradition throughout many countries in the world. And foremost among Ubakin's successors was Goenka, who I never really went into his teaching. He did the sweep method and all sorts of things, and I just didn't find a affinity with them, with that organization. They're pretty structured, and to say, put it nicely. And then taught countless students around the world. And I'm not as serious as these guys. I'm not as disciplined as these guys. I'm okay to do things my own way. And if I have certain attachments, I will be okay with them until I'm in too much pain and need to drop them. There's a different approach. I want to be true to myself, which also, even though there's no self, right? So I'm not at their level, obviously. And therefore, these are people who are profoundly disciplined, and I'm looser, and so everything is looser. But meanwhile, being Mr. Looser or a bit looser, I can bring in the raw material and Nityananda, and Heraclitus and Lin Qi, and Zhuangzi and Lao Tzu, and UFO friend and foe. Is that looser, or is it wider? Or is it looser and wider? Well, both, I guess. Wider scope and looser in a Buddhist framework of discipline and self-restraint. So, you get what you pay for. So, there's value to a tight approach, there's value to a little looser, there's value to a wider scope of consideration of teaching, including UFO studies and transpersonal psychology and, what, Northern California, psychedelic culture, whatever could be valuable from that. Finding value everywhere, anywhere, according to one's own predilection, I think that's fine. And I think that's really where many of us are at. Do it yourself, because otherwise you basically have to join up, and that's fine. But there are limitations there, and then there's the political aspects of all the organizations. So, in any case, this final chapter, part two, the essential practice, called A Happiness That Ever Grows. And what you'll see is Weibo Sayadaw will give some introductory comments, which many of which we've seen before, and we'll see what I call loosely his absolutist approach. Absolutist, not in the sense that he's trying to beat anyone up in dogmatically, but it's pretty straight. And then there is a question of what's wrong with this? Why do I have a problem? Do I have a problem with it? We may chafe, chafe, a bit hearing this. I do, a little. Because he's talking about be perfect, work hard, work, 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 be perfect, do the best, just work and get it. Well, what is wrong with that? But the reality is that nearly none of us will do so. And the disciples too. So what you see in these dialogues again is Weibo Sayadaw talking about this is the mountaintop, you should get to the mountaintop as soon as possible, you should be perfect and get to the mountaintop as countless others have. And the disciple says, yes sir, yes sir, no sir, yes sir, no sir, yes sir, no sir. Because what do you say to somebody who's talking apparently from the mountaintop, saying, come to the mountaintop as soon as possible? What else do you want to do? Why do you have any issue with not coming to the mountaintop as soon as possible, as straight as possible, and working the hardest possible? What's wrong with you? And that's a good question. So we'll get back to that later. That's a very sort of subtle matter, I think. But let me read the chapter. That's going to take a little while, and see what the time looks like after that, and then do some comments, and that'll take several weeks because it's a long chapter. So, part two, the essential practice, chapter, A Happiness That Ever Grows. Weibo Sayadaw said, be perfect in the practice of morality, which is Shila. Only if your practice is perfect will all your aspirations of the present time and of the future be fulfilled without exception. Because this is true, the aspirations of the good people of the past who practiced and strove were fulfilled completely. You too have to take up the practice of that morality that brought about their happiness. Work hard and perfect yourselves in it. Being perfect in morality, keep your mind straight and practice charity, dana, as it pleases you, giving your possessions yourselves with sincerity to those who are worthy. Approach and give your gifts and your respect to the peerless Buddha and his teachings, keeping in mind your aspiration for awakening, nibbana. This type of aspiration is called right aspiration. What you realize when you penetrate the Four Noble Truths is called buddhi, awakening. Bodhi, not buddhi, actually, but they're pretty close. So the word bodhi is of the same root as the other Sanskrit word bodhi, buddhi. So buddhi as discriminative awareness, which is a very interesting way of putting it, the higher mind, very close, related to adicitta, is etymologically related to the word bodhi, awakening, which is of course of the same root as Buddha, the awakened. Buddhi, the function of mind called buddhi, is the function of mind that is nearby and leads very directly into bodhi, which was the attainment of the Buddha or Buddha. So very interesting. There he goes on. There are different types of bodhi. Samasambuddhi, Buddhahood, Paccekabodhi, Bodhi, which here is translated as non-teaching Buddhahood. It's actually solitary Buddha. And Shravaka Bodhi, Arahantship. Shravaka actually means hearer, I believe. There are different, so we've got Buddhahood, or Samasambuddhi, Sama is perfect, Bodhi, Paccekabodhi, non-teaching and solitary Buddhahood, and Sravaka Bodhi, Arahantship. There are different types of Arahantship, Arahatship, Agha Savaka, chief discipleship, Maha Savaka, Maha is great, right? Main disciples, Pakati Savaka, disciple and Arahant. You have to always keep in mind your aspirations for Nibbana, the highest goal. Aspirations thus formed are well formed. After having perfected yourself according to aspiration, enter Nibbana. The noble persons who have attained Nibbana are innumerable. Why could they bring their various aspirations for Buddhi to fruition? Because they had been born into the right form of existence, human, at the right time, and because they exerted proper effort. When is the time when these aspirations can be brought to fruition? From the moment the Buddha awakened or attained awakening, many human beings, devas and brahmas, came to the Buddha to pay respect and show their devotion. This is including, again, devas and brahmas materializing in 3D space-time from higher dimensions. But no human being, no deva, and no brahma was satisfied by merely being in the presence of the Buddha and having the opportunity to pay respect. The Buddha observed them through his mind's eye and taught them the truth, which he had penetrated through his own super knowledge, his omniscience. As soon as they received the instructions of the Buddha, they began to practice, to exert themselves with unwavering energy in all the four postures of the body. The four postures are sitting, standing, walking, and lying down. This effort that is continuous, without break or pause, and full of joy is called good effort. When their effort was perfect and equal to the effort of the wise of old, they arrived at their goal in due time, and all the aspirations of their hearts came to an end. Because they had achieved this state, they were exceedingly happy and blissful. What was the nature of their happiness, their bliss? It was not happiness or bliss that lasted for only a moment or a single lifetime. It was that happiness that is so great that is able to last for the remainder of samsara, meaning for the end, till the end of their career of reincarnation in the 31 planes and then beyond. So it wasn't conditional. Even if you're born in the human plane for only one life, you are able to rise above the suffering of the cycle of birth and death called samsara. In this way, happiness and bliss come to you. When one has attained this happiness, when one has received the sign of bliss, when one has reached the goal, there is no jealous guarding of a secret. No, one will want all human beings, devas and brahmas, to attain this bliss and happiness. As he knows for himself how to attain this happiness, his acts of body, speech, and mind will always be in harmony with the cause of attaining nibbana. He will act with joy as his base, his pada. How could so many human beings, devas and brahmas, attain such high states of bliss? Only because they knew that they're going to bring the aspirations of their heart to fruition. What are the things that support the Buddha's teachings? They are the donation of shelter, robes, alms food, and medicine for the monks. Those are called the four supports: shelter, robes, alms food, and medicine. And this is all that's desired materially by those that only desire Nibbana. Having understood this, they practice it. With these four requisites, the wise supported the teachings of the Buddha. While they supported the teachings of the Buddha by donating the four requisites, these four, many human beings, devas and brahmas, received the instructions of the Buddha, meaning by donation, dana, to the monks of the four requisites. They were endowed with the ability to understand and follow the instructions, and they practice with a joyful mind without taking rest, like the wise of old. When they thus practiced, they attained their goal without delay. In just one moment, innumerable human beings, devas and brahmas, fulfilled the wish of their hearts. The energetic people saw this and supported the teachings of the Buddha and established them in a very short time. But they didn't do only this. This didn't satisfy them yet. In order to strengthen and make firm the teachings, they would also meditate. So they were full of good volition, and they were accordingly endowed with unwavering effort and faith. Since the time of the Buddha, there have been such noble people who supported and carried out the Buddha's teachings with supreme effort. And ever since the days of the Buddha, human beings, devas, and brahmas have been attaining nibbana. The number of those who've attained or reached the goal in just a short moment can't be reckoned, let alone the number of all who have attained nibbana. Now, the good time for all the various noble people has come. This is so, because the time when a Buddha and his teachings blossom is a good time. The existences of human beings, devas, and all the happy abodes, higher dimensions, are good. Having been born into one of these, people accepted the teachings and, as you're doing now, practiced with full effort and arrived at the goal. After his awakening, the Buddha first honored the city of Rajagaha, Rajgir, with his presence. The king of this great city, Bimbisara, very famous character in many Pali suttas, Bimbisara. He came to the Buddha, and because he received the teachings and followed them, he attained the goal, Nibbana. He was full of bliss. He wanted others to attain the same bliss, and understanding the reason, the cause of his happiness, he donated the four requisites to the monks, right? Shelter, robes, food, and medicine. He did this so that his mother, father, grandmother, and grandfather could fulfill their aspirations completely too. The Buddha, out of his great compassion, dwelt in the king's delightful garden. Humans, devas, and brahmas came to revere him there, and with great compassion, he taught them what he had realized himself. In just one short moment, innumerable humans, devas, and brahmas achieved their aspirations. And after this, it went on and on. The good time for all the people with noble aspirations had come. The time at which there is a Buddha or his teaching is a good time. Human life, the life as deva or brahma, is a good life. Good effort is called the effort that is established after one has received the teachings. And what are the Buddhist teachings? What is contained in the Tipitaka and is preached and explained by noble disciples out of loving kindness and compassion are the Buddhist teachings. They are very extensive, profound, and difficult to understand. Though they are extensive, profound, and difficult to understand, they really boil down to just one thing: the way of escape from dukkha. They are expounded by the wise in short and in full as time permits, and everyone has knowledge of them according to his capacity. You all have some understanding of the Tipitaka in accordance with your capabilities. Tipitaka, three baskets, the Sutta, Vinaya, discipline rules, and Abhidhamma commentary. So you all have some understanding of the Tipitaka in accordance with your capabilities. If you were to talk about what you know, it would never end. But you have to establish strong effort and focus your mind on one object and keep out all other objects. When you fix your mind on one object exclusively with strong and stable effort, then you'll be established in the teachings. Isn't this so? And Ubakin says, "Yes, sir." Now, actually, I want to do a little commentary and roll back before, and so he says a lot of things here that are all very interesting and important. And then there's also the discussion of his approach, where he's basically saying, be perfect, work hard, be supreme efforts, make supreme effort. The problem, as I said, is we don't have the same intensity of in the same quality or purity or single mind singleness of intention. We have a mixed set of intentions. This is what Buddhist teachers don't want to talk about, because they don't want to sort of give support to non-dhamma, perhaps, or akkhosala dhamma, or unwholesome, unhelpful tendencies of mind and thus behavior and thus some karmic, bad karmic seeds and entanglement and trouble in the future. Meanwhile, the root of it is we have worldly desires. And there's something wrong to me to simply listen to this teaching and say, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, and not do it. It's better to say, yes, sir, I'm not that great. I'm not like them. And he'll say, don't you want it? And you'll say, yes, I want it. Then why don't you work hard for it? Because there are other things I want. What? You want ignorance and dukkha? No. Well, you'll get more ignorance and dukkha by seeking everything, anything else. Okay. I guess I'm not finished with ignorance and dukkha enough. Ra saying, the proper role for the entity in third density is to experience all things desired. That's a sort of an opposite teaching than what he's saying here. Be perfect in morality. Keep your mind straight. Practice charity. Give your possessions. Give your gifts and give your respect to the peerless Buddha and his teachings. After having perfected yourself according to aspiration, enter Nibbana. Well, that sounds great, but our aspirations are not as pure and as strong and single-focused as his, nor those of the time of the Buddha. Is that giving support to distortion and desire and that which will be incur that which grows ignorance and craving and conceit? Maybe. So it's a hard matter to and I'm not refuting what he's saying. And it's really a call to honesty and authenticity. And just saying yes sir, yes sir, yes sir, yes sir, as everyone does, and I guess I would too. What am I going to say? I'm a fuck up. Please cut me a break. Is that quite the truth? Anyway, this is a very subtle matter. Nityananda didn't teach like this. Nisargadatta didn't teach like this. Most people are not this. I use the word absolutist. And while you can say that any time with the Buddhist teaching is a good teaching, this time, 2,500 years hence from Gautama's birth and death, is a different time of declined Dhamma and declined morality, declined intellect, and declined motivation. Decreased. This is the dark ages of the Dhamma, actually, getting darker. And so some people think this is the best time, or, oh my God, we're at the cutting edge of civilization, the cutting edge of progressive moral, the leading edge of progressive moral superiority and civilizational what? Sanctity or something? They self-righteousness or something? I don't think so at all. And so the noble persons he's referring to grew up in a very different culture where morality was very clearly defined. It's not that everybody was so moral, but it was very clear what was right and wrong, or to one's benefit and not. And the distinction between the two paths was very sharp. The will, the vir of the people was much stronger than today. They may have had you know, less complexity and more distortion, as Ra would say, where today we have more complexity and less distortion. So while we have less distortion, the minds are tangled and complicated and neurotic. In the old days, the duller, dimmer minds 2,500 years ago of the majority, not the arahants and those people who took the teachings, but those who rejected teaching or did no teaching or just couldn't, you know, not simply uneducated, but incapable of subtle thought, because this is a kind of advanced teaching, advanced life experience to listen to Buddha Dhamma and take it to heart and practice and make final attainment. It's not that everybody did it. Most people couldn't do it. And the mind at that time, while less complicated, Ra said, less complex, would be called more distorted, which really means less capable of higher mental functioning, I think. A darker or dimmer field of mind, where today the field of mind is brighter, but much more polluted. In the old days, the mind was less polluted with neurotic and self-harming tendency. Because we're talking about neurosis is self-harm. The root of humanity's problems is self-harm. This is a self-harming, self-deceiving, self-sabotaging race. You know, 3D repeating is done by self-sabotage. It's done by unrecognized self-limitation. Lack of self-trust, lack of authenticity, lack of honesty in being real with oneself, being honest with oneself about this and that. So more neurotic today, more self-harming today, more confused in motivation, and more dispersed or diffused. Confused, I don't know. Confused, we can say, but it's really diffused. The diffusion of intention. Intention is not single laser focused, like he's speaking of, like he was, like the noble ones of old were. And so their various aspirations for buddhi were brought to fruition because they born in the right time, the right form of existence, and they exerted proper effort. It didn't happen right away. Some listened to teachings and immediately had one of the four attainments, meaning they listen to a teaching and bang, goes get the Dhamma eye and it becomes Sotapanna. Listen to the teachings and bang, they hit Arahant. Why? Because that's already a yoga, yogi listening. That's already a highly evolved soul ready for final attainment. But some had a lot of trouble in meditation. But in general, those who attained any of the attainments had quite a straight path towards those attainments. Today, you can't just say that you can sit in joy and joyfully move to enlightenment. Even Gautama struggled heavily. A whole lot of suffering Gautama went through. And he doesn't seem to recognize maybe he recognizes it, but he's talking a good talk here that as soon as they received instructions of the Buddha, they began to practice. That's true, those of old. They exerted themselves with unwavering energy in all the four postures of the body. True. Continuous effort without pause or break and full of joy. Really? Were they all full of joy? Was Gautama full of joy on the path before he became the Buddha? I don't think so. He was working very hard. He was full of frustration, because every attainment he had, he knew was not the final. So, you know, I don't think one can expect to. None of us are going to. I mean, even the monks around him, Ubakin was this way. Did effort was continuous without break and pause and full of joy? Really? I mean, Ledi Sayadaw, okay. Weibo Sayadaw, okay. But the Ubakin and the successors, really? Did they do continuous effort without break, without pause, and full of joy till they all attained complete and perfect enlightenment? Maybe. They all did. And I'm the moron who's just criticizing. But I'm not actually criticizing. What I'm really saying is this is a call to honesty. And you fool yourself, that's not a good idea, right? There have been countless scandals in the Tibetan Buddhist and Japanese Buddhist sanghas in the West. Many, dozens, several dozen scandals. While people talked a good talk. They talked a good talk. Meanwhile, these Tibetan and Japanese Zen Buddhist sanghas had multiple scandals, multiple sanghas with multiple scandals. So they talk a good talk, and I'm not comparing those teachers to Weibo Sayadaw at all, but I'm saying they all talked a good talk and were not honest about what was happening right in front of their nose. That's not a good idea. And I wouldn't talk above my own level of practice and reality and effort and intention. And you just can't expect, it just is not true that certainly at this time, 2,500 years hence, in the third millennium of the five millennium given by the Gautama as the ages of the Dhamma's steady decline from his death, and effort, continuous effort without pause or break and full of joy is going to happen much. I mean, really? If you're full of joy, then it doesn't sound like it's painful to practice. So then why don't people do that? Because it's not full of joy. It's full of challenge, and there are periods of bliss, and there are periods of joy, and there are breakthroughs, and then there's all sorts of pain. So I don't want to talk a good talk if it's untrue. I mean, you can do whatever you want, and I don't think I'm in the wrong here. And that's no disparaging, you know. I mean, it looks to me like Ledi Sayadaw and Weibo Sayadaw and a whole lot of many were supremely, had final attainment. But there's a difference, you know, like in the Taoist view, there's a difference between the attainment of the sage and the skill of a sage, or the talent, the heart of the sage, or the talent of the skill of a sage. There's a difference between attainment and teaching. And there are great teachers who teach greatly, wonderfully, who haven't had final attainment. There are beings who've had final attainment, and their teaching is in some ways not fitting, or doesn't fit well, some in certain ways, because it's too high. They're too pure. So I don't know, you know, it's not a criticism of, I mean, I think Weibo Sayadaw is on our hot here. But I don't think it's realistic to, I don't think it's honest to just say, yes, sir, and not do what he's saying we should do. It's like getting married and saying, till death do us part, and then divorcing. You shouldn't have said, till death do us part, if you ever had any intention of divorcing. That's not nice. That's a lie. You promise and break your promise. If there's a chance of breaking the promise, don't make the promise. No? I mean, that's what people do. They make a promise, they break a promise. That's okay. I don't like that. I don't want to do that. If there's a chance I'll break the promise, I don't want to make a promise. Is that not right? Is that wrong? I think that's right. Don't make promises you're absolutely sure you can keep. Don't say yes, sir, when you can't, you won't do what he says everyone should do. And actually, the reality is that continuous effort without break and pause is not full of joy for those of us, or for all of us. I don't see any teacher who went from his or her level of attainment to final attainment full of joy the whole time. This is just not true. Maybe I'm missing something. But their effort was perfect and equal to the effort of the wise of old. They arrived at their goal in due time. Aspirations of their hearts came to an end. That's what'll happen. So one attains in line with one's aspirations. One has become what one wished to become. What one was seeking, one does find. Where all beings are where they have sought to be, even if it's a very bad place or bad condition of body, mind, spirit, or bad physical environment, their desires, our desires, get us to where we are. Our desires make us who we are. We have made ourselves what we are. What we are is made by us with our own set of desires or aspirations or intentions, which are partly conscious and partly subconscious, partly known and partly unknown. And not for nearly all of us, except for the ones in the temple, in the forest, in the cave, working hard and not listening to this talk here, mixed between the worldly, physical, emotional, interactional desires and the desire for continued soul evolution and complete and perfect enlightenment. This is not an unimportant point, I think. The other point that's, I think, critical is, what the heck's this all about? It's about becoming exceedingly happy and blissful. It's not a moral challenge, a moral identity issue. Like, you meditate and you're good, you don't meditate and you're bad, you seek complete and perfect enlightenment, you're good, and if you don't, you're bad. One way of understanding this is, how much happiness and bliss and joy do you want? How much happiness, joy, and bliss, that's the order. There's pleasure of the body, body, mind. There's happiness, very much of the mind, heart. There's a joy of the heart, spirit, and there's bliss of spirit that just suffuses body, body, mind. So how much, just how much? And pleasure is not about here. It's not about sensual. So how much happiness and joy and bliss do you want? If you want more, this is the way. But you won't be progressing joyfully with continuous effort without pause or break. Or if you do continuous effort without pause or break, you won't be full of joy. Right? Is that a problem? So, honesty is rare. Even in the Sangha, sorry, when they're talking about themselves, when they're talking about each other. That's what I've seen. You know, how many scandals do you have to get in the Buddha, in the Tibetan? Now, it's not in the Burmese, not in the Thai, not in the Sri Lankan, not in the Chinese Buddhist sanghas, actually. Very rare, almost never, do you have scandals in Burmese, Thai, Sri Lankan, and Chinese Buddhist communities. But in the Tibetan and the Buddhist, or Tibetan and the Japanese, which are the most prominent in the West, actually, there's scandals all over the place. Why? Because there's some chronic dishonesty in play. Now, that's not Weibo Sayadaw. That's not Burmese Buddhism. That's not Vipassana. That's not Theravadan groups in the U.S. That's Japanese and Tibetan. That doesn't mean that every teacher is a scoundrel either. Not at all. Some are amazing and wonderful and, you know, fully attained, obviously. Obviously, you know. but you know, there's also a bit of self-deception. Huh? And there's a bit of... either how dare you be critical, or we want the white scarf and we want the daddy to pat us on the head and say you're good boys and girls. We want the love, we want their love, we want the love of the guru, we want the love of the teacher. Love me, teacher, please. Meanwhile, some of the teachers are scoundrels. And that's, you know, if one doesn't do self-critique, one doesn't improve. And that's the problem with a lot of Earth humanity. If we don't do self-critique, we don't improve. How do we grow? We grow by realizing where we are deficient or out of balance or distorted or wrong and mistaken and doing harm or off base or something. We progress by acknowledging problems and acknowledging our responsibility for problems. We acknowledge the problem, we acknowledge and look into the nature of the problem, we take rightful responsibility for the problem and authorship responsibility for the problem that I am making, that I've made, that I do, that I'm responsible for. And then I seek to make some change, and that would be improvement. So... rightful regret and remorse, rightful guilt and shame. Very important. and where the scandals arose, the community had not done so, had not rightfully been self-introspective. And that's all really what I'm talking about is my understanding of rigorous honesty and authenticity. And to say yes sir, yes sir, yes sir, and then not to intend to do it, there's something wrong with that to me. So, but the whole thing is about happy and blissful. The nature, the happiness, the bliss that never ends. Yes. And when one has received, they're attained, so the idea is Nibbana is eternal happiness and bliss. Yeah. I mean, I'm not there, but I can see how that would be. There's a sense of all that has been, all that should be done has been done. Complete. It's finished. It is finished. This apparent, this apparent I and the work that I've felt to do to get out of suffering and to finish with reincarnation and rebirth is done. It's finished. Wow. And then there's the state of mind associated with seventh chakra perfection. The seventh chakra perfection sufficient to get out of the octave after death. That's kind of a high development. I mean, full open door from six to seven or something. I don't know what it is energetically, but it's a tremendous happiness or tremendous joy. And so, if one doesn't practice hard, one doesn't want it enough, or doesn't want to go through the pain, actually, of the practice of meeting the distortion, distorted self, the distortions of mind, the distortion leavings of lower chakra blockages, and the pain and wounding that we carry had been unhealed. We don't want to meet that. The cost of meeting that seems too high to the benefit of the bliss and joy and endless happiness of final attainment. So, but like Gautama said, in the five ages of the Dhamma, in this age today, from maybe it's an Abhidhamma view that, so it's an Abhidhamma view of Gautama's teaching of these five millennia of the decline of the Dhamma. In the third, the major attainment would be actually non-returner, not even Arahant. Arahant was the major, was more available in the first 1,000 years and the second 1,000 years, meaning up to 1500 AD. It's still available today, for sure, but it's much more rare. And that's obviously what's happening here. Obviously what's happening here. That each generation, I mean, were the students, how many of the students of Ledi Sayadaw, Uba, and Weibo Sayadaw, how many were Arahants, really? I don't know, but I don't see their successors to be the same as of the same attainment as some people like Ledi Sayadaw and Weibo Sayadaw. It's just it's so the decline of the Dhamma is the darkening, period of Kali Yuga, you can say, and Gautama, forecast it rightly, and here in the third millennium. After Gautama's passing, it's not that common to see Arahants. It's much more common to see non-returners. And that's where a lot of these teachers are, actually. Not Ledi Sayadaw, not the monks in the forest, but the laymen or their successors and their successors' successors out in the world. At best, many of them would be non-returners. Some are Arahants, and people argue about all these things all the time, right? My teacher's an Arahant. Who the fuck are you? Yeah, who the fuck am I? So who the fuck are you? Who do you care? What do you care what I think? When people critique, it's silly, very silly. If you don't like it, why you even waste your precious time listening to something you don't like? There are not many people like that, but there are people in the world that stay to criticize. They don't want to leave. They want to stay. And remain critical. There are not many people I meet like that, or the channel, or this or that, but it's just a strange set, it's a strange mind. I stay to remain critical. I remain to be critical. I'm here to be critical. Not I'm here to be happy. Not I'm living to be happy or well. I'm here to be critical. And you should know it. Something like that. It's a very distorted mind. It's really self-punishment, actually. So this is a darker age. And to compare ourselves, as he does, to the great disciples and the hearers, the arahants of the time of Gautama, I think it doesn't fit, really. So, okay. What else? He said, now the good time for all the various noble people has come. I don't know. I mean, to me, this is sort of putting a beautiful cast on a much more mixed up situation. The time when the Buddha teachings blossom is a good time. Of course, it's all good stuff. The other thing, though, that is very, I think, more useful, the story of King Bimbisara after attaining enlightenment and great happiness, bliss of completion and the deathless, wanted, by his joy, he was happy to help. By his joy at having attained just what the teachings and Gautama offered and said could be attained. He wanted to share that. And this is actually a very important point, is that the higher the attainment, the more happy one is to share rightly so others have attainment too. The desire to speak freely so others may benefit themselves, so others may help themselves. That comes naturally. Generosity grows as the lower triad is cleared. As one's more healed, generosity of, not particularly money, money maybe yes or no, giving things, material things, that's just one form of generosity. Higher generosity is giving truth and love and kindness and care, giving attention, giving patient attention, caring attention, you know, when you can, when it's right, when the situation is thus, and then truth and discernment and teaching of this or that, you know. Generosity is a sign of development, and the greater beings are greatly generous because they have nothing, like Nityananda, right? Day in, day out, they thronged him in Ganesh Puri. They thronged him day in and day out. You think he wanted that? What did he get from it? He was doing his danda. And that was the cost of a logoic incarnation, I think. And everything they gave him went out the door in a few hours. That's my understanding. Maybe I'm wrong. My understanding is everything that went in, the gold and the money and the food and the clothing and the countless things they gave to him, he gave it all to the community and died with a loincloth and didn't even need that. They just wanted him to wear it. And ate because, you know, you just got to keep his teeth from falling out. But he wanted nothing because he had everything. You know, like Lucy said, I am everywhere. End of the movie, Lucy. I'm everywhere. Yeah, I is everywhere. And when the seeker becomes the I that is everywhere, the seeker is everywhere. The seeker becomes all and finishes with this all and enters the next all. And seeks naturally, wants nothing, wants to grasp and hold no thing of this all. Thus all or any that comes through or to, anything that comes to him goes through him. For all. So, okay, that's pretty cool. So, but this point here, Bimbisara, full of bliss, wanted others to attain the same bliss, and understanding the reason, the cause of his happiness, he donated the four requisites. He wanted others to attain the same bliss. He was so well, he wanted others to be well. And those that stay to critique, or when we're in our life stuck, which is a kind of self-punishment as well, we can't be well, much well to others, because we're not well with ourselves or with the life we have made for ourselves right now. And so, attainment, development, is salvific. Salvific. It's of increasing salve or salvation or freeing. It's mukti, moksha. It's on the way to mukti, moksha, liberation from bondage, freedom, mukti, freedom. Freedom of what? Freedom of being, free being, increasingly free over the time of development. And then, as the mind or the being experiences greater freedom, there's a less holding, grasping, to hold and get and keep and protect. Because what you hold holds you. And the grasping actually represents continued certain types of chakra blockages, lower triad blockages, particularly. Unconditionally accepting is actually not holding on to anything. Green, the maximal green ray, Anahata chakra, the maximal, as far as I can tell, because I'm not there, maximal, would be absolute total accepting being with all. That means non-control, at the level of mind, where grasping and aversion, I don't want it all, I want to reject some of it. I want to control it somehow. I want to modify it. I want to modify, I want to control, I want to stop, I want to increase, I want to decrease, I want to balance, I want to this and that, the other thing. Doesn't happen in the maximal green ray, as far as I can tell. It doesn't happen in absolute wu wei. It doesn't happen in maximal pure sati mindfulness. There's just steady attention. All that arises is not interfered with. The wu wei is the approach to that which still arises. And that means non-interruption, non-interference. It is as let it be. It is as it is, and I wish to let it be just as it is, just as is, because I've surrendered the tendencies of control associated with wishing to modify a phenomenal flow. There's a certain freedom to that. It also doesn't happen soon, or the maximal is the end of the path. Enlightenment, we keep talking about enlightenment, enlightenment, self-realization, Satchitananda, Nibbana, or attainment. These are the culminations of effort. These are the culminations of development. The culmination happens once, after a course of development. Meanwhile, we can recognize development by progressive change over time. Meaning, I feel more well today than before. I feel more naturally generous today than before. Or I feel more stuck. Well, how stuck? Well, that's a matter of how well are you able to look into it. Stuck how? I'm so messed up. Oh my God. Actually, if we could, blow away some of the mist, what you'd find is the person's just stuck or unwell or in angst or conflict about a particular matter or several particular matters. And identifying them and looking into them rightly cordons them off, rightly bounds, gives a proper bounding to what's really the problem today. Just say, oh my God, my life's such a mess. This is a second chakra blockage, fogging the intellect, emotionalism fogging clarity of discernment. The discernment is actually there are several things that are really, really bothering me. Here's one, two, three, four. And that's very helpful. That's what good therapy involves, or part of what good therapy would involve is identifying issues clearly in a defined way, identifying and defining the issues, and then addressing each one sequentially or all together. And so There are indications of development, but there's a path or a course of what appears to be incremental, gradual improvement or development. And just talking about maximal effort and hit the goal, in some ways supports neglect. It supports or encourages neglect of the nitty-gritty of development along the path, and as well as the fact that we're simply, not going to live what he sa how he says we should live. I mean, I don't think anybody, I mean, even the great teacher, the Western teachers of Vipassana, if they're not Arahants, they've not done what he said they should do. Yeah? So I'm not saying a hypocrisy even. I'm just saying, be honest. Be honest about things. It's good to be honest, I think, and it's good to be honest to in acknowledging that we still have worldly aspirations, non, the supramundane and mundane. We still have mundane aspirations, and thus the path will be slow, but there can be steady development, and the more development, the more one will feel freedom, whatever that means, which is really a freeing from binding, and that is more well-being. Meanwhile, one will hit troubles along the way. Meanwhile, there are certain things that, or angst that one has carried for decades, perhaps we all have. Should we not talk about that? In the Sangha, you're not supposed to. In many Sanghas, you're not supposed to. Just like in those Tibetan and Japanese Sanghas where scandals arose, there was a gag order unstated for years. Self-gagging. So, this is why I wouldn't want to be part of one of these groups, any of the groups, actually, because they end up devolving to certain common 3D repeater distortions, blind spots, blockages, avoidances. And that's part of the story. That's part of the truth that the world we're living in here. So, but close to the end, and I'm going to wrap it up in this if I can. Yeah, we're almost in an hour. His comment, I mean, his comments are all beautiful and wonderful. It's just a matter of fit. The rightful fit between his teaching and our life, and not fooling oneself and not playing games with oneself. But he's the second to last paragraph in this section that precedes the dialogue with Ubakin. He said about the Tipitaka, these teachings in the Tipitaka, they are very extensive, profound, and difficult to understand. Yeah. Though they are extensive, profound, and difficult to understand, they really boil down to just one thing, the way of escape from suffering. That's it. The way of escape from suffering. And back to Iddhipada from Virada, Virada Sutta, Sammuttanikaya Nikaya, from the Wikipedia page on Iddhipada. Because those who have neglected the four bases for spiritual power have neglected the noble path leading to the complete destruction of dukkha. Those who have undertaken the four bases of spiritual power have undertaken the noble path leading to the destruction of dukkha. And so the bases, the Iddhipada, again, intention or purpose, chanda, effort or energy or will, virya, mind, awareness, citta, and then investigation or discrimination, vimamsa. And so these are the ways of destroying suffering. The end of the path is the end of dukkha. Dukkha suffering, there are other better words for dukkha than suffering, I understand. the destruction of suffering, the destruction of dukkha, the end of that. Effort is required, but I guess I would just say that the effort of my approach here is to increase effort along the last of the four, called vimamsa, or investigation, discrimination, where know yourself is critical. And that's another way, that's the Delphic oracle maxim of path to God, know thyself. And that's still true. Know thyself as the true nature of anatta and nibbana and the deathless. Know thyself as the deathless, completely transpersonal. So that'll be it for today. And again, the heart of Gautama's teaching, or all the teaching of all the Buddhas, Dhammapada 183, translated by Buddharakita, translated by Tanisaro, to avoid all evil or non-doing of any evil, the performance of what's skillful, or to cultivate good, and to cleanse one's mind, or cleansing of one's own mind. This is the teaching of all the Buddhas. And so, restraint from picking up or continuing the harmful, the encouragement to virtue and generosity and goodness, right speech, right action, and the development of the disciplines needed and the training to develop concentration and a higher mind and wisdom and attainment, which is the purification of consciousness. That's it. That's the Buddhist path. And that's really beautiful. And everybody takes it their own way. So, that's it for today. So, next time, I'll pick up in the next portion of this third chapter, part two, with the dialogue between Weibo Sayadaw and Uba Khin. So, I hope it's been helpful for you. Please take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.